Hello friends, I am Dr. Avnish Goel. I completed my MD Dermatology, Venereology and Leprology in 2006. Since then, I am practicing dermatology and educating dermatology at various platforms. I welcome you all on this Unacademy platform in which you can have pocket-friendly live interactive session from top educators and you can access them from anywhere in this world. Nowadays, medical marathon is going on Unacademy platform in which you can have rapid revision of the subjects. All my upcoming sessions here on YouTube will be image based and these are to help you to crack questions on computers and also to keep you stimulated. So boys and girls, let's crack it. So coming to the first slide. So this is the first slide. You have to identify the disease. Your choices are pitriasis versicolor, pitriasis rosea, pitriasis rubra pilaris, and tinea corporis. So once again, have a look at the slide. Pitriasis versicolor, pitriasis rosea, pitriasis rubra pilaris, and tinea corporis. So the correct answer is it is a slide of pitriasis rosea. So coming to the discussion, pitriasis rosea is characterized by symmetrical exanthemes with a collarette of the scales. So you will have an exanthematous plaque on which you will have peripheral collarette of scales. So this is a classical picture of pitriasis rosea. It is seen on the trunk of young adults. Etiology, it is associated with human herpes virus 7, so it could be a viral infection. Otherwise, various drugs are also implicated such as arsenic, bismuth, metronidazole and isotretinoin. Initially there will be a large oval patch. Also called as Herald patch. The large patch is called as Herald patch. It is absent in 20% of the patients. Later, there will be multiple small skin lesions and they will be along the skin lines. So around the ribs, along the skin lines or the fur tree pattern, all these characterize the smaller lesion of pitriasis rosea. They may be associated with moderate to severe pruritus. So this is a clinical description of the pitriasis rosea Herald patch followed by multiple smaller lesion along the skin line in a fur tree pattern. What about the treatment? So treatment is mainly with antihistaminics, then topical steroids, then you can give emollients, and the latest concept is that high dose of acyclovir. So considering it as a viral infection, acyclovir is given for the treatment of pitriasis rosea. Now coming to the other choice in the question, pitriasis rubra pilaris. It has got three alphabets, PRP, pitriasis rubra pilaris. So these three alphabets can be taken as mnemonic for this disorder. The P can stand for palmoplantar keratoderma, the R for red color or salmon color scaly plaques with island of sparing, and P for perifollicular rough red papule. So this is PRP or pitriasis rubra pilaris. You have to treat it with retinoids. Coming to the next question, identify the disorder. So here you are seeing a mucosal lesion and you have to identify the disorder. Your choices are mucus patch of syphilis, white reticulate lichen planus, pemphigus and pemphigoid. Mucus patch of syphilis, white reticulate lichen planus, pemphigus and pemphigoid. And the correct answer is, it is a white reticulate lichen planus. So lesions in lichen planus or oral lesions in lichen planus, they are seen in around 50% of the patients. The reticulate, the white reticulate pattern is most characteristic. Otherwise, atrophic, papular, erosive, and bullous variants are other variants which can be type of oral lesion in lichen planus. The various nail changes in lichen planus, it can be pterygium formation, pup tent sign due to formation of a papule of lichen planus on nail bed. The nail plate is elevated both longitudinally and laterally. That is a pup tent sign. Then subungual hyperkeratosis and uniform thinning. So these are nail changes in lichen planus. So remember, white reticulate pattern is most characteristic in lichen planus. Question number 3. Here is a histological picture and you have to identify the disease. I'll give a few clues about the picture. Let us have a look at the choices. The choices are lepromatous leprosy, systemic lupus erythematosus, lichen planus, and psoriasis. Once again, whether it is a LL Hansen's, systemic lupus erythematosus, then lichen planus or psoriasis. Now, few tips. You can see hyperkeratosis, you can see hypergranulosis, and you can see acanthosis, and you can see separation of epidermis and dermis. So this is a histological picture of lichen planus. So lichen planus is characterized by hyperkeratosis, the thickening of the stratum corneum, parakeratosis, it means that is there are no nucleated cells in stratum corneum. No nucleated cells in the stratum corneum. Then there can be irregular acanthosis. Acanthosis is increased in the spinous layer, the increase in the stratum spinosum. Then focal hypergranulosis, increase in the granular layer, which the focal hypergranulosis may give a sawtooth pattern. Basal cell degeneration. So this basal cell degeneration may lead to formation of these bodies, also known as colloid or civet bodies. The basal cell, in basal cell degeneration, what happens? The degenerated keratinocytes of the epidermis, they fall into the dermis and they form these colloid bodies. The colloid bodies are 20 micrometer in size. They represent degenerated keratinocytes and they are IgM staining. So in this basal cell degeneration, the epidermal cells, due to the degenerated basal cell, it falls into the dermis and form a body that is called as colloid bodies. Otherwise, there is a space which I have shown you, that is Max-Joseph space. Max-Joseph space is area of separation between epidermis and dermis. Similar space is seen in LL Hansen, and that space is called Gren's zone. So Gren's zone and Max-Joseph spaces, they are the separation of epidermis and dermis. Max-Joseph spaces are seen in lichen planus and Gren's zone in lepromatous leprosy. Now coming to the another histological picture, you have to identify the disease. Have a look at the histological picture and identify the disease. Then I will give you clues. Your choices are LL Hansen's, SLE, lichen planus, and psoriasis. LL Hansen's, SLE, lichen planus, and psoriasis. So this is a, in this picture, you can appreciate hyperkeratosis. Hyperkeratosis is there. Then there is collection of cells. Collection of cells in the epidermis. Then the see the pattern of this reticulum. The see the characteristic pattern. So this is a histological picture of psoriasis. So in histology of psoriasis, you will see hyperkeratosis. Parakeratosis means the stratum corneum cells will have nucleus. Some of the cells, they may have nucleus. So it is characterized by parakeratosis. Then Munro's microabscesses. Munro's microabscesses are neutrophils in stratum corneum. Other microabscesses are, which can be seen in dermatology, are papillary tip microabscesses. Papillary tip microabscesses, they are seen in dermatitis herpetiformis. And Potrayer's microabscesses, that is seen in mycosis fungoides. So these are few other types of microabscesses. Munro's microabscesses are seen in psoriasis. Then pustules of Kogos, they are neutrophils in the stratum malpighi. The neutrophils in the stratum malpighi. Then acanthosis, that is increased in the spinous layer, papillomatosis. Then reticulum pattern, which I was showing you, it's characteristic. The characteristic pattern is called camel foot reticulum. Then there will be suprapapillary thinning. and squirting papilla. Squirting papilla is neutrophils ejecting from dilated capillaries. So these are characteristic histological features of lichen planus, psoriasis. Coming to the next slide, you have to identify the cause of this deformity. You are seeing an arthritic picture and you have to identify the cause. You are seeing classical distal interphalangeal joint involvement. Your choices are rheumatoid arthritis, psoriatic arthritis, gonococcal arthritis and syphilitic arthritis. Rheumatoid arthritis, psoriatic arthritis, gonococcal arthritis and syphilitic arthritis. So the classical distal interphalangeal joint is a feature of psoriatic arthritis. So psoriatic arthritis, it can be either symmetrical polyarthritis, asymmetrical oligoarthritis, then classical, the classical being distal interphalangeal joint involvement that we are seeing in this patient. Then the another type is arthritis mutilans, which can have opera glass or penicillin cup deformity, and axial arthritis, which has got bywater diction lesions. So these are types of psoriatic arthritis and seen in psoriatic patients. Coming to the next question, the following is associated with, you are seeing at a picture of the tip of great toe and you have to tell the association of the following. The choices are onychomycosis, pustular psoriasis, paronychia and candidiasis. Onychomycosis, pustular psoriasis, candidia and paronychia and candidiasis. So this is a picture of acrodermatitis continua of Hallopio, or it is a localized type of pustular psoriasis. So pustular psoriasis can be classified into localized further has got two variants, palmoplantar pustulosis and acrodermatitis continua of Hallopio. Then generalized is acute generalized, which has got a particular name, von Zumbusch disease. Then pustular psoriasis of pregnancy, which is a misnomer. The name given to it is a misnomer, impetigo herpetiformis. It is neither impetigo neither herpetiformis. So it is pustular psoriasis, the other name for pustular psoriasis of pregnancy. And the questions commonly asked pertaining to this impetigo herpetiformis is the treatment of impetigo herpetiformis is steroids. So treatment for pustular psoriasis in pregnancy or impetigo herpetiformis is steroids. Don't jump to the any bacterial infection just by looking at impetigo. So impetigo herpetiformis is a type of pustular psoriasis of pregnancy. Then other one is infantile and juvenile, succinate and localized. So these are type of generalized type of pustular psoriasis. The following is associated with, again you are seeing pustules and plaques. I have given you the clue. Subcorneal pustular dermatosis, linear IgA disease, pustular psoriasis and dermatitis herpetiformis. You are seeing the collection of pustules, plaques and following is associated with subcorneal pustular dermatosis, linear IgA disease, pustular psoriasis and dermatitis herpetiformis. So the answer is that this is a clinical picture of generalized pustular psoriasis or von Zumbusch disease. So von Zumbusch disease is acute generalized life-threatening disorder. So it is acute generalized severe life-threatening disorder because it is characterized by lakes of pus that are plaques studded with superficial sterile pustules. So they are called lakes of pus. It is associated with low-grade fever, pain and burning sensation. Now various predisposing feature factors for this pustular psoriasis is over-treatment with TARS, anthralines, potent topical steroids, systemic therapy with progesterone and steroids, infections, pregnancy and hypocalcemia. So these are the few predisposing factors for a plaque of psoriasis to turn to a pustular psoriasis. That is over-treatment with TAR, anthralines, potent topical steroids, systemic therapy with progesterone, steroids, infection, pregnancy and hypocalcemia. Coming to the next question, you have to identify the disorder. Your choices are lichen nitidus, Darius disease, nevus and lichen planus. Lichen nitidus, Darius disease, nevus and lichen planus. So these are lesions of lichen planus. So lichen planus is an idiopathic, subacute or chronic inflammatory process. It is associated with hepatitis C viral infection. So lichen planus is associated with hepatitis C viral infections. Cobner's phenomena can be seen, coil Cobner's or isomorphic phenomena, gold and mercury filling. So these are few important associations of lichen planus. Clinically, lichen planus is characterized by 5 P's. Those 5 P's are, first P stand for pruritic, second for purple, third for polygonal, fourth for plain topped, and fifth P for papules and plaques. So these are 5 P's of lichen planus. Then purple color of lichen planus plaque is due to Tyndall effect, and Wickham's striae are the lesions seen on the lesion of lichen planus, are the structures seen on the lesion of lichen planus. They are due to focal hypergranulosis, and they can be better seen with application of mineral oil. So next question, you have to identify the disorder. And your choices are lichen planus, Darius disease, psoriasis, secondary syphilis. Lichen planus, Darius disease, psoriasis and secondary syphilis. You are seeing at a plaque with scaling. So this is a classical picture of psoriasis. So psoriasis is the correct answer. The psoriasis is characterized by well defined, the borders are well defined, erythematous, scaly plaques, and there will be no symptom to severe pruritus. Silvery scales, silvery because of trapped air, and they are also called as micaceous scales. Silvery micaceous scales are characteristic of psoriasis vulgaris. The silvery color is due to trapped air. Now there are various signs and tests associated with psoriasis, and they are sometimes asked in the question. First, Caretta's test. The coherence of scales gives a feeling of scratching candle wax. The coherence of scales gives a feeling of scratching candle wax. Then is Auspitz sign. Auspitz sign was asked in last Sunday's AIMS exam. It is pinpoint bleeding, though there the clinical photograph was shown. Auspitz sign is a pinpoint bleeding on scraping due to dilated capillaries. Pinpoint bleeding on scraping due to dilated capillaries. Membrane of Bulkley on scraping, moist red basement membrane zone is exposed and dilated capillaries are seen as red spots. So that is membrane of Bulkley. Then Voronoff's ring, that is zone of hypopigmentation around plaques, and due to decreased prostaglandin synthesis. Cobner's and reverse Cobner's phenomena can be seen with the psoriasis vulgaris. Now this Cobner's phenomena, apart from psoriasis, it can be seen with lichen planus, vitiligo, lichen nitidus, Kaposi sarcoma, pitriasis rubra pilaris, Darius disease, and DLE. So these lesions, apart from psoriasis, can show like a Cobner's phenomena or isomorphic phenomena. And the pseudo Cobner's phenomena is seen with warts, molluscum contagiosum, and eczemas predominantly. So Cobner's is isomorphic, appearance of similar lesions on trauma. Reverse Cobner's is disappearance of the lesion on trauma, and pseudo Cobner's, it is due to autoaccumulation or inherit property of the disease itself. So pseudo Cobner's seen phenomena is seen in warts, molluscum contagiosum, and eczemas. Next question, you have to identify the disorder. You are seeing tense blister in a lady. You have to identify the disorder. Few of them have ruptured. So your choices are pemphigus, pemphigoid, epidermolysis bullosa simplex, and Hailey-Hailey disease. Either it is pemphigus, you have to tell whether it's pemphigus, pemphigoid, epidermolysis bullosa simplex, and Hailey-Hailey disease. Have a look at the photograph. So to me, it looks like a picture of pemphigoid because you can see a tense blister. The bullous pemphigoid will always be having tense blister because here the level of split is lower down. While in pemphigus vulgaris and pemphigus foliaceus, you will see flaccid blisters or no blisters at all, only the erosions. So tense blisters, it is usually seen in the pemphigoid group of disorders. So bullous pemphigoid, it is most commonly seen in males, in the sixth decade, antibodies to BP230 and BP180. They are two antigens for bullous pemphigoid, which leads to separation at the basement membrane zone. This antibodies they localize to epidermal site in salt split skin. So if you treat the skin specimen with 1 molar sodium chloride, there will be a split at the level of lamina lucida. There will be a split at the level of lamina lucida, and after a split, if you see the localization of antibodies, it will be towards the epidermal site. So this salt split technique is used to produce a split at the level of lamina lucida. Clinically, bullous pemphigoid is characterized by tense blister, because it is in the dermis, or it is in the superficial below the epidermis. Subepidermal blisters, tense blister with preceding urticarial plaque. So this is important. The bullous pemphigoid lesions, they appear on lesions, urticarial plaque type lesions, and these plaques, they appear 1 to 3 weeks before the appearance of the bullous pemphigoid lesions. So tense blister with preceding urticarial plaques associated with severe itching is associated with bullous pemphigoid. The site being lower abdomen, thighs, axillae, flexures, and face and scalp are less commonly involved. Mucosal lesions can be seen, but they are less common and less severe. This is in comparison to pemphigus vulgaris, wherein they are more severe. Nikolsky sign is negative, and Buller spread sign or Esbo Hansen sign can be positive or can be negative. So this is for bullous pemphigoid. Remember the antigen, remember the presentation, mucosal eruption, then the Nikolsky sign, application of a torsional pressure, it leads to a split at the level, at the split between the skin. So it can, if this Nikolsky sign is characteristic of pemphigus group of disorder, it can be negative in bullous pemphigoid. Bullous spread sign is vertical pressure on a bulla, the bulla spreads further. This is also called as Esbo-Hansen sign. Now this is a histological picture, and you have to identify the disorder. Looking at the histological picture, you have to identify the disorder. These questions are very commonly asked in the exams. So either it is pemphigus, pemphigoid, dermatitis herpetiformis, or Hailey-Hailey disease. So whether it is pemphigus, pemphigoid, dermatitis herpetiformis, or Hailey-Hailey disease. Have a look at the picture once again. Pemphigus, pemphigoid, dermatitis herpetiformis, or Hailey-Hailey disease. So the correct answer is, herein you are getting subepidermal bulla. So it is a picture of pemphigoid. So investigations of bullous pemphigoid, Zhang smear will show no acantholysis. Acantholysis is a characteristic of pemphigus group of disorders. Then eosinophilic infiltrates. So this eosinophilic infiltrates are characteristic for this bullous pemphigoid. Then urticarial plaque associated with itching, eosinophilic infiltrates, all seen in bullous pemphigoid. Histologically, you will see subepidermal blister as you are seeing in this clinical photograph. Then eosinophilic infiltrates. Direct immunofluorescence, you can see linear IgG and C3 at basement membrane zone. In direct immunofluorescence, you will see circulating IgG and C3. So direct is for the lesional immunoglobulins, and indirect for the circulating immunoglobulins. And in that indirect immunofluorescence, the titer of circulating antibodies, which are there in the blood, they do not correlate with the disease activity. While this is not true for pemphigus vulgaris, the circulating antibodies usually they correlate with the disease activity. Now you are seeing a histological slide once again, and you have to identify the disorder. Here again you are seeing a split, a particular pattern. You have to identify the disorder. Your choices are pemphigus, pemphigoid, dermatitis herpetiformis, and Hailey-Hailey disease. Pemphigus, pemphigoid, dermatitis herpetiformis, and Hailey-Hailey disease. Pemphigus, pemphigoid, dermatitis herpetiformis, and Hailey-Hailey disease. So this is a classical histological picture of pemphigus or pemphigus vulgaris. So pemphigus vulgaris is a potential life-threatening condition. It is a life-threatening condition. Any stratified squamous epithelia can be affected. Any stratified squamous epithelia is affected. IgG against desmoglein 3 can lead to acantholysis. Clinically, it is characterized by flaccid bullae, since they are superficial, large, thin-walled, and they appear on normal skin. This is in comparison to what we have seen in bullous pemphigoid. Lesion of pemphigus vulgaris appear on the normal skin. They erode to form ulcers. These ulcers can be multiple, progressive, painful, with little tendency to heal. Grayish necrotic slough. Nikolsky sign is positive here, and bullous spread sign is also positive. So, this is about the pemphigus vulgaris. It can affect, the bulla will be seen on normal skin, and there will be large flaccid bullae, multiple, progressive, painful, with little tendency to heal. There will be grayish necrotic slough will be there, and bulla spread sign and Nikolsky sign will be positive. Investigations of bullous pemphigus vulgaris, Zang smear will show acantholytic cells. What is acantholytic cell? An acantholytic cell, it is a large cell, large epidermal cell with peripheral, with large nucleus, then large nucleus and peripheral condensation of cytoplasm. So this is a acantholytic cell. In the skin biopsy, you will see suprabasal cleavage. What you are seeing in this slide is suprabasal cleavage and row of tombstone appearance. Row of tombstone appearance is characteristic of pemphigus vulgaris. Row of tombstone appearance. This is a very important point to be remembered, because this way or that way, examiners will ask about the row of tombstone appearance, and these are characteristic of pemphigus vulgaris. Otherwise, in DIF, you will see IgG and C3 in the intercellular spaces. Between the cells, you will see the deposition of IgG and C3. Again, they have got a particular pattern that is called as fishnet pattern. IgG and C3 in the intercellular spaces in a fishnet pattern is characteristic of pemphigus vulgaris. So remember, row of tombstone appearance and fishnet pattern of deposition of immunoglobulins. While in indirect immunofluorescence, you will see circulating IgG and C3, and in 80% of the cases, the level, the titer of the circulating immunoglobulins, they correlate with the disease activity in pemphigus vulgaris. Now, next slide, you have to identify the cause. So you are seeing at the oral erosions, and you have to identify the cause. Your choices are oral LP, oral pemphigoid, oral pemphigus, and herpetic gingivostomatitis. Oral LP, then oral pemphigoid, oral pemphigus, and herpetic gingivostomatitis. So these are your choices. So the correct answer is, here it is oral pemphigus, but similar picture can be seen in oral lichen planus also. I have told you that oral lichen planus may have a erosive variant which looks very much similar to what we are seeing in this patient. So always look at the skin of the patient to make the diagnosis of the oral lesions. So this is a patient of oral pemphigus. So mucosal lesions are seen in 70%. So quite a high number of patients show the mucosal eruptions in a patient of pemphigus vulgaris. It is characterized by painful persistent ulcer, as with the skin, little tendency to heal, and other mucosa are also involved in severe cases. In severe cases of pemphigus vulgaris, other mucosas are also involved. So this is oral pemphigus vulgaris. Now, coming to the following is a clinical presentation of. Your choices are pemphigus vulgaris, pemphigus erythematosus, pemphigus vegetans, pemphigus foliaceus. Pemphigus vulgaris, pemphigus erythematosus, pemphigus foliaceus, and pemphigus vegetans. So this is a clinical presentation of pemphigus foliaceus. So pemphigus foliaceus, here it is characterized by most superficial blistering. The blistering is very superficial. So by the time patient present to you, there will not be any blisters, only the scaling. So most superficial blistering disorder, here the antibodies are autoantibodies are towards against desmoglein 1, as in comparison to pemphigus vulgaris, wherein they were against desmoglein 3, here they are against desmoglein 1. The split here is either at the level of granular layer or in the stratum corneum. This disease is a photosensitive disorder and it is exacerbated by sun exposure. Scaling, crusting, erythema and mousy odor are seen with pemphigus foliaceus. There is a variant of pemphigus foliaceus called as Fogo salvagium, also called as endemic pemphigus foliaceus, commonly seen in Brazil, and it is associated with IgG4 against desmoglein 1. So pemphigus foliaceus, most superficial blistering disorder, antibodies desmoglein 1, and it is a photosensitive disorder. The split is in the granular layer or in the stratum corneum, and it is characterized by scaling, erythema, crusting and mousy odor. Now this is a direct immunofluorescence picture, and you have to tell that this is suggestive of, your choices are bullous pemphigoid, pemphigus vulgaris, dermatitis herpetiformis and Hailey-Hailey disease. Bullous pemphigoid, pemphigus vulgaris, dermatitis herpetiformis and Hailey-Hailey disease. So again, have a look at the clinic, at the direct immunofluorescence picture. So this is a direct immunofluorescence picture of pemphigus vulgaris, because what you are seeing is a deposition of immunoglobulins in the intracellular spaces. So this is a classical fishnet pattern of pemphigus vulgaris. Now you are seeing at a direct immunofluorescence picture, you have to tell it is associated with which disorder out of the following. Your choices are bullous pemphigoid, pemphigus vulgaris, dermatitis herpetiformis and Hailey-Hailey disease. Bullous pemphigoid, pemphigus vulgaris, dermatitis herpetiformis and Hailey-Hailey disease. So this is a direct immunofluorescence picture of bullous pemphigoid, because in full bullous pemphigoid you will see a linear pattern. You are seeing a linear pattern of immunoglobulins, that is IgG and C3 at the basement membrane zone. So here you will get linear IgG and C3 at the basement membrane zone. Coming to the last question, second last question. These are one of the few last questions. Following are the findings in, you are seeing at a histopathological picture and you are seeing a direct immunofluorescence picture also, two pictures. So you have to tell me the following are the finding in. Your choices are bullous pemphigoid, pemphigus vulgaris, dermatitis herpetiformis and Hailey-Hailey disease. Bullous pemphigoid, pemphigus vulgaris, dermatitis herpetiformis and Hailey-Hailey disease. So this is a histological picture and there is a direct immunofluorescence picture. So the correct answer is dermatitis herpetiformis. So because what you are seeing is the IgA deposits at the papillary tip. So I have told you papillary tip microabscesses. So this is papillary tip IgA deposit which are seen in dermatitis herpetiformis. So dermatitis herpetiformis, also called as Durings disease, it is associated with gluten sensitive enteropathy. Clinically, you will see polymorphic lesions, the multiple morphologic lesions preceded by intense itching and burning. So this disorder is characterized by intense itching and burning over the elbows, knees, upper back and face. So it looks, the lesions are so much excoriated and scabbed that it looks like the patient has got any itchy disorder, particularly scabies. So lesions are excoriated and scabbed. Oral lesions are also there, but though they are common, they are asymptomatic. So herein, in dermatitis herpetiformis, you will see polymorphic lesions over the elbow, knees, upper back and face, and they are excoriated and scabbed. Investigations on histology, you will see papillary tip microabscesses, as you were seeing in this picture. They are that these microabscesses are called as DH bodies, which are 0.1 micrometer in size, amorphous granules at papillary tip. Then direct immunofluorescence will show granular IgA deposits at the papillary tip and membrane, basement membrane zone, that I've shown in the clinical photograph. And provocation test, the provocation test with potassium iodide injection will lead to dermatitis herpetiformic like lesion in 24 to 48 hours. So there is a provocation test, a potassium iodide is ingested and it leads to DH like lesions in 24 to 48 hours. Next slide. So this is the last slide for today's discussion. You have to identify the disease. Your choices are intertrigo, Hailey-Hailey disease, pemphigus vegetans, and pemphigus erythematosus. Intertrigo, Hailey-Hailey disease, pemphigus vegetans, and pemphigus erythematosus. So it is a clinical picture of pemphigus vegetans. So pemphigus vegetans is nothing but it is a benign variant of pemphigus vulgaris. It is a just a variant of pemphigus vulgaris. It has got two subtypes, Newman type and halopiotype. What happens in pemphigus vegetans? The eroded area of pemphigus vulgaris, the eroded area of pemphigus vulgaris does not heal like usual, but form papillomatous growth and vegetations. So here earlier pemphigus vulgaris sort of lesion would have been, but they heal unusually to form papillomatous growth and vegetations. Usually it appears as vegetating exuberant lesion in the moist intertriginous area. So pemphigus vegetans is just a variant of pemphigus vulgaris. Now a brief discussion about Hailey-Hailey disease. Hailey-Hailey disease is also known as familial chronic benign pemphigus. Familial chronic benign pemphigus, and it is a not autoimmune process. So it is not an autoimmune process and there is no autoantibodies. It is further characterized by minute vesicles, erosion, crusting and fissures in the intertriginous area. No oral lesions are seen. Malformation of desmosomes. Malformation of desmosomes causes acantholysis. Since it is not an autoimmune disorder, there is no autoantibodies. Histologically, it is characterized by dilapidated brick wall appearance. Dilapidated brick wall appearance. It's a multiple choice question again. Dilapidated brick wall appearance is a histological features of Hailey-Hailey disease. So here DIF will be negative because there is no autoantibodies, and the differential diagnosis of Hailey-Hailey disease can be candidiasis, can be frictional dermatitis or inverse psoriasis. So this is about the Hailey-Hailey disease. So friends, hope you like the session. This is my referral code, DocAbhi@5397. I urge you to get the Unacademy Plus subscription for your better results in the examination. My referral code is here on the screen. I request you to like, comment and subscribe to this YouTube channel. Thank you.